Hope you all enjoyed your three-day weekend. Made use of your time. You got a whole extra day. So do whatever you want to do. Today's pre-class question is, what did you do with that day off, with that extra 24 hours? Diksha says I got all my assignments turned in. Good. Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm working on catching up on grading because I fell a little behind. Not gonna lie. That's on me. So I'm working on fixing that, getting that turned in. So good job. Ryan says I took my grandma home back to Tucson. It was like a 4-hour drive altogether. It was a good time. We got Taco Bell too. Taco Bell is always a good time. That drive to Tucson is so brutal because there's absolutely nothing to look at. It's rough, but Taco Bell makes things better. Vera Diaz says I went to the mall and got to spend time with my family. Honestly, I love the mall. I could go to the mall all day. Like, especially Scottsdale Fashion Mall. Love it. Great time. Spend time with your family. Love that. Oh, where'd it go? Angela says I went to a quince and went out to eat with my sister. I have never been to a quince, okay? Never been. And I hate it. I want to go so bad. But none of my friends, like, had quince's. Like, it was so upsetting. Now I just have to find someone to, like, marry whose nieces and cousins have quince's so I can get to go to one. Because it's just not fair. They look like they're so much fun, and I want to go so bad. Javian says, this weekend we celebrated my bonus mom, her stepmom. I love that you call her your bonus mom. That is so cute. It was her birthday. I love that. I hope it was fun. I really like that. That was fun. Roger said he did nothing. Fair enough. You don't have to do anything on your day off. That's the point of it. Leslie said, I finished watching BoJack Horseman. I heard the show's really funny. I've never, like, sat down and watched it, but I've heard it's hilarious. Janitzi says, went to go to work with my dad's, with my dad at his company. That sounds cool. What's your dad do?
He's like the main one.
Oh, nice. Did he make you do stuff?
Well, he just went to go do one of our
interviews. Nice. At least it's only one. I used to hate going to, like, parent-teacher, like, parent-student, like, bring a kid to work day things. My parents actually made me do stuff. But this is dumb. I'd rather be in school. So Donnie said I spent the whole day working on my yard, which I love doing. This is why I never want to buy a house. Yard work. Not for me. Not a fan. Could have a little garden. Cool with me. Weeding, all that. Not a fan. He also said I grilled some carne asada for my fam for dinner. I love carne asada. I wish I wasn't so Midwestern to the point where I don't know how to make it. I have to go get it from, like, Taco Boys, which is down the street. if I ever want it. So it's kind of upsetting, but it's fine. Shahir said I went thrifting on Saturday and bought some clothes. Where do you thrift? Because my thrifting skills are not, like, I frequent Goodwill, and, like, that's about it. One of my friends found it's like a plate that has JFK and Jackie on it. It literally is like a plate from the 60s with JFK on it. And that was so cool. But I'm like, she found it at Goodwill. I'm like, who gives this away? Oh, but here's that he goes to Goodwill, that one near my house. Oh, okay, then I'm doing it right. It makes me feel better. That it's not just like me. I thought I wasn't doing it right. Cool. Anyone else? What'd you do for your 3-day weekend? Okay. Well, thank you for sharing for those that did. I appreciate you all. I'm going to pull up our game plan for you. Go with that. So it's March 30th. Is your volume on your computer on there? Can you turn it down a little bit? I can just hear myself, and it's, like, throwing me off. Thank you. So it's March 30th. You're almost to April. Only a few more weeks left of school. That's a good sign. Your objective is to analyze how institutions, individuals, and groups deal with that economic crisis. So we talked about on Friday, the stock market crashes. We are now in the depression. So today we're talking about life during the depression. So for our game plan, I have a little bell ringer for you. It's on hobo markings. So there's a lot of homeless people in the 1930s during the depression. They usually have their own different distinctive language, kind of similar to 1920 slang. So different symbols mean different things. We're going to try to figure out if you guys would make good hobos. Our presentation is on life in the depression. It's that quizzes format, so you're going to join the presentation. It's a couple questions answered. It's not too hard. And then I have a photo analysis for you on photos during the Great Depression. It's six photos, six questions with each photo. We're going to do the first one together so we know what to look for, how to do it. So due this week, that photo analysis is going to be due today because we're going to have time to work on it. We're going to do it together. So that's going to work out. And then the current events for this week, it's on new technology or inventions, whichever one, gotta mean the same thing. CNN 10 talks about a new invention like every day. So I want you all to find a new invention or technology that you find interesting, write about it, tell me about it. That's going to be due on Friday. Okay, so you have a few days. I know it's a short week, so you don't get your full time like you usually would, but still get some form of time. So are there any questions, comments, concerns, problems with what we're doing today? No? Cool. Okay. I'm gonna pull up our little bell ringer, our hobo markings quiz. Hobos. During the Great Depression, some people, mostly men and teenage boys, so people your age, sometimes even younger, are going to take advantage of that homelessness, of not having a home to live in, and they're going to ride the rails across the United States. They're going to jump on trains, pretty much ride them wherever they go. They really didn't have a set destination. They were just kind of riding the rails, living their life. Okay? Some people are going to react in different ways to these homeless people or hobos. Some people are very accepting of hobos. Some people don't like them. Hobos are wanderers. They're going to use markings to help other hobos that are going to follow them. So pretty much just to give them a heads up at what may lie in that area. Whether it be a dog, people that are willing to give you food, stuff like that. Hobos are going to develop this language to help other hobos. These signs may be left in chalk on a fence post, on the side of a building, or some other place that's going to be visible to other hobos who came later on. So anyway that they can see them. The only problem with chalk is when it rains, it washes away. So sometimes the markings aren't going to stay, but they're there. So we're going to take a little quiz to see how well you do as a hobo during the Great Depression. So they're going to give you, I'm going to read you the scenario, it's going to give you the marking, and there's going to be three options for you to do. You're going to choose one, two, or three, put which one you chose in the meeting chat. I have it next to me to see. You're going to pick which one you would do based on the marking you see, and then it's going to give you what the marking means and how you would fare to your decision of how well you chose. Okay? So the first scenario, you jump off a train when it slows down at a small town crossing. After wandering through town, you stop at a small, cozy looking farm just outside the town. The smell of freshly baked bread is going to waft toward you from the open kitchen window, because someone's baking bread in their home. You're about to go try to sneak some of the bread when you notice the marking below in white chalk on the side of the fence post. So what do you do? Number one, do you steal the bread? Number two, do you knock on the door and ask for food? Or number three, do you keep walking? This is the little sign that you see on the fence post, that little triangle, arm looking things. So that's the sign you see on the fence post. So based on that sign, are you going to steal the bread, knock on the door and ask for food, or keep walking? So put one, two, or three in the meeting chat based on what you would do in this scenario. Roger says two. Okay, what would you all do? What are we thinking based on what we see? Harris says keep walking, so number three. Janitzi says number two. What about my virtual people? What would we do? Again, steal the breath, knock on the door and ask, or keep walking. Ryan says number three, so keep walking. Let's get like one more. Diksha says number three, keep walking. Okay. So hopefully, you're going to keep walking because that sign means man with a gun. So if you tried to steal the bread, you could have been shot. I don't know where they get this symbol of this means someone has a gun in their home. Oh, your hands are up. I see. Okay, that makes sense. Makes a whole lot of sense. Thanks, Adonia. I didn't get it. I would have been like, let's steal it, you know? So a man with a gun is that little triangle with the little arms. Okay, so if you chose to keep walking, going to keep walking until you see another farmhouse and an old barn. You think you'll try to sneak into the barn and sleep there for the night, but you notice the marking below carved into a nearby fence post. So that circle with the X in it, right over here, okay? Based on the marking you see, do you, number one, sleep in the barn, number two, go to the farmhouse and ask for food, or number three, keep walking? You see a farmhouse with this old barn. You think you're going to go into the barn and sleep for the night, but you see this marking on the fence post. What do? So go ahead and put your response in the meeting chat. One, two, or three. Number one, you sleep in the barn. Number two, go to the farmhouse and ask for food. Or number three, do you keep walking? So let's get some responses in the meeting chat here. What would you do? Bitten if you hop the fence. So that means mean dog here. So this person prior to those beware of dog signs. It's before those existed. So we have a sign for man with gun, X marks the spot of good for handouts, and then mean dog here with like a depiction of their teeth. Got a couple more. So you see the following sign, these arrows on the right, on the side of a brick building while you're walking through town. So what do you think this sign is telling you? That you should, number one, get out of town quick, number two, ask for a job, or number three, pretend that you are sick. You see these little arrows on the side of a building downtown. What do you think you should do? Number one, get out of town quick, number two, ask for a job, or number three, pretend you're sick. Roger says number one, Harris says number one, so get out of town quick. Get a couple more responses. What would we do? What do you think? Diksha says number one. Okay. So this sign, the little arrow, means that work is available. So to go inside the building and see if you can go get a job for a day. So it's like a shovel. Looks like an arrow, but it's a shovel. So a lot of the time, a lot of businesses would hire people just for a day. Like you get paid for doing a little small minimal work. So if you saw a little shovel, it means that there's work available for you. So try and make some money. Okay, last one. So you're about to leave town when you see the following sign near your house. A triangle with a little top hat on it. You can hear the train coming and you want to catch it, but the sign makes you pause. Should you, number one, ask for a handout at this house, number two, ask for a job, or number three, catch your train? So based on that little one, little triangle, what are you trying to do? Roger says number three, catch your train. Harris says ask for a job. A couple more, what would we do? Based on that little triangle with the hat. One more guess. Okay. You need one more person to try and guess. What would you do based on this sign? Would you go catch your train, ask for a job, or ask for a handout? My virtual people. Let's see, one person to guess. Thank you, Jenzi. Jenzi says number two, to ask for a job. Okay. So you might actually want to go catch the next train. This might be a good place to ask for money, however, so not necessarily a job, but try and get some money. That sign means wealthy people live here, so that's what the little top hat is depicting. A lot of rich people wore top hats. Not a stereotype, it actually happened. So pretty much, how'd you do? If you got 4 out of 5, you're a super hobo, you'd be able to survive. If you got about 2 out of 3, you're kind of a poser. You might want to talk to other hobos to learn what these markings mean. 0 or 1 correct answers. Don't become a hobo. Don't do it. Live in a tent. I don't know what to tell you, but don't ride the rails. Because you won't make it. Okay? So we got to see what hobo life was like. So now we're going to pull up our presentation on full daily life during the Depression. It's a quizzes presentation. So you may either go to joinmyquiz.com and put that game code in, or here's the link for you to join. If you click on that link, you can join in. But it takes 2 minutes. Get joined in before we start. Thank you. are you the R? Okay, I wanna make sure. Janitzi. Couple more people in. Another one that's worth you in our class. So get joined in. Yeah, not optional. Diksha, thank you. This is where your attendance is taken for the day. Now we have another minute to get joined in. Like 30 more seconds. So please get joined in if you're not already. Low. So a lot of farmers would destroy their own crops in order to try to decrease the supply, make it even to the demand, that way prices could be increased, you could charge more for it, make more of a profit off of it. So this is a photo of hobos riding the rails. They would literally jump on the train as they are moving. Quite dangerous. There's going to be droughts that are going to occur on the Great Plains. So that area of Oklahoma, Texas, Kansas, Nebraska, that's the Great Plains region. This region is also going to be known as the Dust Bowl because it's so dry. So kind of similar to out here. We don't get a lot of rain. When it gets windy, dust blows around a lot faster. Similar aspect. Many are going to move west to California looking for work because the dust storms are going to destroy their crops. So it's dry, there's no rain, so crops are unable to grow successfully. So many people are going to lose their farms in the Great Plains and move west in search of work. These people are often called Okies because most were from Oklahoma. So Oklahoma was largely impacted by the Dust Bowl, so most of their citizens are going to be moving west. They're referred to as Okies. Kind of an abbreviation. Are there any questions so far? Anything? If there is, please let me know. Okay, so this is a photo of the Dust Bowl. So you can see there's houses on the bottom. You see the dust blowing around, coming in. Kind of looks like almost like a tornado of dust. That reminds me of monsoon season, but no, without the rain. So The Grapes of Wrath is written in 1939. It's a novel that's written by John Steinbeck, and it's about one family's struggle in moving to California. So the family is from the Great Plains, they're experiencing the Dust Bowl, and they're trying to get to California in search of work. And it's a huge struggle. So that's pretty much what the novel's about. It follows the family. We have President Hoover, again, who's blamed for the Depression. He's not willing to spend enough money to provide relief to the people. So this is prior to unemployment assistance from the government. There's not a lot of welfare. That's not a thing yet. So President Hoover isn't willing to spend U.S. government money to give the people relief. He's not really willing to help out. So this is another photo from the Dust Bowl from the Great Plains. They already live in like a little shack. It's being destroyed. So we have like children that are affected, a lot of families that lived off these farms that are really being impacted. Because I knew I skipped something. Another question for you. So most people migrating to California during the Dust Bowl were from where? So where were they from? Had a little special nickname for them. Where are most people that were impacted by the Dust Bowl from migrating to California? While they were serving in the war, but now they're getting a little bonus check for them. The money was supposed to be paid in 1945, so they planned it out in 1924, Congress approves it, it's supposed to be paid in 1945. However, in June of 1932, 20,000 veterans are going to march into Washington, D.C. They're going to set up camps and say they wouldn't leave until they received their bonuses. Okay? So they're pretty much going to be, most people don't have jobs, not earning income. They want this bonus now. They don't want to wait until 1945. They believe they should be paid it now. So you're going to have veterans that are going to march to D.C. You're going to set up camp. And they're pretty much saying they're going to occupy D.C. until they're paid. So almost kind of like a strike. Like when unions go on strike, kind of similar. Hoover is going to order the police to remove these protesters. So he's going to tell the police to make the protesters get up and leave. If they don't, figure out a way to get them to leave. Don't take no for an answer. Two veterans are going to be killed by the police. And this is going to make Hoover look really bad. So, especially following World War I, veterans are treated with a much higher respect. You took that time to serve your country. And because Hoover orders the police to remove their protesters, and they're the reason the veterans are killed, they're going to blame Hoover. So Hoover already has the depression blamed on him. Now he has the death of two veterans blamed on him, all because they are trying to receive their payment. So Hoover is not looking too hot, not looking too great. This is a photo of the Bonus Army March. As you can see, it's a little boring. A lot of veterans in D.C. Are there any questions so far? That's a lot of information. Okay. So we have the introduction of Franklin D. Roosevelt, or FDR. He's going to defeat Hoover in the election of 1932. So Hoover runs for re-election. Obviously, he's not very liked by the American people. So FDR is going to win the election of 1932. He's the cousin to Teddy Roosevelt. So we talked about Roosevelt. He served as president. He was a member of the Rough Riders, one of the first presidents of the Progressive Era. FDR becomes ill with polio in 1921. And it's going to force him to use a wheelchair. So polio, huge. During the 1910s, 1920s, a lot of people that get polio had to be placed in an iron lung. They either were paralyzed or they didn't survive. So FDR survives, but he has to use a wheelchair, he's paralyzed. We now have a vaccine for polio, so, you know. He is the first president to use the radio regularly. He has what is known as fireside chats. So these are when he's going to explain his plans for how to fix the depression and fake news his plans and programs to the American people. So he would go on the radio several times, we call it once a week, about have a fireside chat, tell the American people, this is what I plan to do, these are the programs I plan to introduce, this is how we're going to get out of this. Okay? So he made himself known in the American household pretty quickly. And everyone knew his plans. Like he was nothing, like there was nothing kept secret. With FDR. So this is FDR giving one of his fireside chats utilizing the radio. You see NBC, still a news station, CBS, still a news station. So FDR utilized the news and the radio quite often. He was not shy. He handles the press very well. For example, there's not like pictures aren't taken of him in his wheelchair. He would do from the belly up, but there was never anything of him in his wheelchair. He doesn't want to appear weak. At the time, disabled people are viewed as very weak. In that sense, he's in a wheelchair, he's disabled. He doesn't want to come across to the American people as weak. He's a strong person in office, that's what he wants to appear as. So if you just look at photos of FDR, you're not going to assume that he was in a wheelchair. You would never know. He has this famous quote, people still say today, all we have to fear is fear itself. So he pretty much says, there's nothing to be afraid of. We're going to get out of this. The only thing that you should be afraid of is your own fear. Okay? He's pretty much saying to not be afraid of it. We're going to be okay. The Brain Trust is his group of advisors that help him. So his attorneys, his economists, political scientists. So it's kind of like his cabinet. We talked about when y'all were taking your civics exam. So it's kind of like his cabinet. It's his trusted advisors, people that are closest to him. It's his attorneys, economists, and political scientists. So he has a group close to him that is going to help him get out of this. I have a question for you. So what were FDR's radio announcements called? When he did his little regular scheduled radio announcements, what were they called?
Trying to fix the depression.
5 of you say yes, 1 of you says no, 2 of you say no. For the 2 of you that say no, what would your, like, solution be? Huh? Oh, it's okay. But so for the 1 of you that says no, and, like, meant to put no, what would your strategy be? You put it in the meeting chat. Take your time. But what do you think would be a good solution? You don't want to start with the banks. What are you going to start with? Roger got first place with our score. Yay. Again, so for the 1 of you who said no, put in the meeting chat what you think your solution would be. Like, where would you start? If you were the President of the United States, you were FDR, where would you start? Would you develop some programs? Would you avoid the banks altogether? What would you do? While you're putting that in the chat, I'm going to pull up our assignment for today. Okay. So we have a Great Depression photo analysis. So, like I said earlier, it's under the assignments tab in Teams, so go ahead and get that pulled up. I'll give you about a minute or two to get that pulled up. I just posted it during the second hour, so it's pretty new. It's titled Great Depression Photo Analysis, or Great Depression Analysis. So go ahead and get that pulled up. While you're doing that, there's 6 different documents, so 6 different photos. There's 6 questions for each photo. They are all the same questions for each photo, however. Okay, so you're doing the same analysis for each photo. So I'm going to do the first one with you because it's a photo we've looked at before. So as I go along, follow along with me. So for question 1, it says observe the shapes, colors, textures, the position of people and or objects. Pretty much, what do you see? And you need 5 bullet points about what you see. So while you're looking at the photo, what I've seen, it's in black and white. There weren't a lot of photos in color at the time. But it's in black and white, so it's very dark. So I'm going to put that. I'm going to put black and white. And then put that it's dark, okay? I see a mother holding her infant and her son on her shoulder. So I'm going to put that, the people, she's holding the baby, and another child is standing over her shoulder. You can also see, let me scroll up a little bit. There's a like wooden stick in the middle that's most likely holding up the tent that they've created. It doesn't look like it looks pretty sharp, it looks kind of dangerous. You can also see the texture of the tent in the background. It looks pretty battered and ripped, so it's not well structured. It's not put together very well. So you could put a wooden stick holding up the tent. Specifically, where was the photo taken, so you know, so you can analyze where they live. what they're going through. So I would put, where was this photo taken? And then you can also ask, when or where are they from? What year was this taken, if it doesn't tell you? What did the woman do before? Is her husband around? Pretty much any basic generic question about the people in the photo, you can ask, okay? Question number three, what is the mood? So how does this image make you feel? That's what it's asking. So it asks you the mood, how does it make you feel? I asked you this during the presentation, it's the same photo. What does the image make you feel? So by looking at the photo above, I would say this photo makes me feel sad. You can literally just put sad, make it generic. Make it one or two bullets. What's the mood? So it's dark, depressing. That's the mood. So it makes me feel sad. The photo is dark and depressing. It gets the point across, okay? It's doing what it's supposed to do. Question number four, what do you think the photographer is trying to say? So by that photo, what do you think the photographer is trying to tell you? So based on looking at this woman, so you can go back to your question number three, what does it make you feel? And then you can go relate that to number four, what do you think he's trying to say? So if you think the photographer is trying to make you feel sad and upset for this woman, that's what you would put. You would literally write, you think the photographer trying to make people sad and relate to the woman, feel bad for her. So what do you think by each photo the photographer is trying to tell you? Each photo has a meaning. There's a reason why the photographer takes that picture. So think about why you think the photographer felt the need to take that photo. So why do you think he felt the need to take the photo of this woman sitting in her tent with her children, okay? So when you're looking at the photo, be sure to think about that. Question number five, who do you think is the intended audience? So that's kind of when we were looking at propaganda posters, you can think about who they were trying to get at, who they were trying to aim the photo toward. Same thing. So do you think that the photographer was trying to focus on other women, on men, on the government? Your intended audience could be the government, try to make the government feel bad. Who do you think the intended audience is? So for that photo, personally, I think the government is the intended audience. They want the government to see what is happening to these people, to see children suffering, women and children. They're trying to appeal to those emotions. And then last question. So you need one bullet point for this one as well. So what do you think, or what do these pictures tell us about life during the Depression? So what does this one picture tell you about life during the Depression? So you saw a woman with her children sitting in a tent, most likely living during the Dust Bowl. So what do you think the picture is trying to tell us about life during the Depression? So pretty much, I would write that the photo of the migrant mother is trying to tell us that the Great Depression affected families. Trying to get after it. Try to make people feel. Who do you think the intended audience is? So by looking at the photo, do you think they're aiming towards other women, men, other children, the government to develop programs? Who do you think they're trying to get that photo to? And question six asks, what do these pictures tell us about life during the Depression? So by looking at the photo, what do you think they're trying to get across based on life? Like, what do you think their goal is? Okay. Each question, each photo has the same questions. So photo two is titled White Angel Red Line. The other thing I suggest is to look at the titles. The titles can tell you a lot about the photo, what they're trying to depict, who they're trying to aim toward. I would really look at the title of each photo. This one, White Angel Red Line. Again, same six questions. Number three, next time try the train. So you can see two hobos walking the streets with a billboard that says next time try the train and to relax. Trains cost money, so we had a lot of people hopping on the trains illegally, the railway runners, you know. That's number three, same questions. Number four is titled Sharecroppers Prepare to Have Their Picture Taken. So you see the sharecroppers, they live on farms. They are preparing to have their photo taken. They're trying to look nice, make themselves look good, like pleasing. You have four children and the farmer. That actually might be a wife, but I would think of a child. Again, same questions. What do you see? What do you think the audience is? The mood? The next one is titled Mule Team and Poster. So you can see there's a donkey or a mule carrying a wagon. There's a poster for a show to attend in Alabama. And that is the last one, okay? So it's actually five photos, sorry. You have to do four of them on your own because we did the first one together. So do not worry about doing the migrant mother. We already did it. Or you can take my answers that I did. Works for me, but you don't have to do document A, but do document B, C, D, and E on your own, okay? Take the rest of class, so about 30-ish minutes, a little bit more than that, to get this done. If you have any questions, do not hesitate to put it in the meeting chat, message me personally. We are here for that. So if there are no questions about the assignment, you are free to get to work on it. Again, if you have any questions that come up while you're looking, please let me know. That's what I'm here for. Sound good? Stay in the meeting so I can take attendance. But go ahead and get some work done.